Breaking the Trust Barrier: How Leaders Close the Gaps for High Performance by JV Venable. Read for you by Dave Clark. Foreword. Can born leaders teach others to lead? Robert L. Jollis, best-selling author of Customer-Centered Selling. JV Venable is a born leader. You'd sense it if you ever stood near him. You'd know it if you ever heard him speak. You'd feel it if you ever shook his hand. His backstory is inspiring, and his accomplishments are amazing. But can a born leader like JV teach you to lead others? Many leaders have been dogged by this same question. After all, if these skills are so innate, can they be consciously laid out in a process for others to learn and apply? Typically, those who are blessed with natural skills struggle to teach others the skills they so effortlessly command. This is because the skills that come so naturally are ones they have never really had to stop and assess. If someone put a golf club in your hand and you could easily hit the ball 300 yards down the middle of the fairway, would you stop and study that swing? You might simply enjoy the gift you were born with. Now imagine that this same person decided to try to teach others how to duplicate that swing. It's no coincidence that those who are born with certain gifts, academic or physical, typically make poor teachers. Ironically, it's far more common to find that the most effective teachers and coaches are not born with the skills they teach. Those skills did not come naturally to them. As a matter of fact, they learned those skills the hard way, by trial and error, bit by bit. Being consciously aware of every move you make allows you to naturally verbalize those lessons to others. Every now and then, however, someone comes along who is the exception to this rule. And in this case, that person is JV Venable. He was born to lead, and he was given the opportunity to study his gift from his time as the commander and demonstration leader of the US Air Force Thunderbirds. He led an 1,100-member combat group on flying missions in Iraq and Afghanistan, and he was an Air Force officer and fighter pilot with 26 years on the point. It is the combination of the instinctive skills and the conscious understanding of exactly what those skills are that can make someone an exceptional teacher. What makes this book a treasure is not based on JV's accomplishments, but rather on the way JV can help you accomplish great things. In Breaking the Trust Barrier, JV has successfully and clearly articulated the leadership skills necessary for you to be successful with your teams. How does he do this? He inspires, entertains, and motivates you through his ability to not just tell a story, but to provide a clear moral to that story and tie that moral to a defined leadership action. JV doesn't just want to tell you how to become a more effective leader. He sincerely wants you to succeed at it. He starts by getting you to look at your team and identify gaps that can cause a lack of competence. Then, he walks you through the commitment you extend to those you lead, the often small acts of loyalty that further the interest of those behind you. There is a big surge of energy when, due to the trust you have created, you can lead others to take the drag from your draft. This book offers far more than just inspirational stories that generate an idea or two. In fact, what's presented here are repeatable step-by-step processes that are measurable and therefore implementable. In turn, you learn a systematic approach to leadership that can be adapted instantly to fit virtually any situation or scenario. Seek more in the pages that follow, and you will be handsomely rewarded. There is one learning demon that you'll need to be aware of, especially if you are already a good leader. This is the voice in your head that whispers, "I'm already an effective leader. Isn't that good enough?" Being too good to learn more or to think you can't improve on your leadership skills just doesn't make sense. When I was a 21-year-old insurance agent for New York Life, I learned an invaluable lesson that I'd like to share. It was decided that we would try filming the insurance agents and give them an opportunity to evaluate their performances. In addition, I would provide feedback. I was pretty green, but I was coached on what to look for, and I was ready to go. A form was placed in everyone's mailbox. It spoke about this new and rare opportunity to view one's approach to selling and get some feedback. It was a mandatory exercise for all 21 of the recently hired apprentice field underwriters, AFUs, but optional for the other 57 agents. Of these 57 agents, 52 were tenured agents and 5 were chairman's council agents, the most successful agents in the country, representing the top 2.5% of the sales force. At the bottom of the form, to help with scheduling, it was requested that all agents respond either yes or no. What followed was something I will never forget. Of the 78 forms that were returned, as expected, all 21 AFUs requested various filming dates and times. Not one of the 52 tenured agents chose to take advantage of this learning experience. And ironically, the only agents who wanted to participate were all 5 Chairman's Council agents. In other words, the top agents in the country were the only ones who wanted to learn how to be even better agents. But wait, there's more. Many of the AFUs were a little put off by the experience, going through the motions and casually nodding at the feedback they received. When the Chairman's Council agents came through, each one had a pad of paper and never stopped asking questions and taking notes. Each of the Chairman's Council agents, 5 of our best in the country, came to the filming obsessed with getting better. What those 5 agents taught me was that there are many common traits that successful people share. One trait that seemed of paramount importance was a desire to improve, no matter what one's current level of success might be. Now, let's apply this lesson to this book. You've accomplished the hard part. You've picked this book up. You may already be a good leader, but reading this book will help you be an even better leader. You'll need to think about it and digest the messages. You'll want to try to implement the lessons you will learn, and if you do that, you'll see your leadership skills improve. You'll want to thank JV Venable for writing this book because he will make you a better leader. You've come this far. Now go even further and let a born leader and exceptional teacher take you further than you could ever imagine. Preface. The most demanding and gratifying leadership role of my life was my time as the commander and demonstration leader of the United States Air Force Thunderbirds. My selection for that position was the culmination of a lifelong dream. The passion for flying began when I was 4 years old, standing on the roof of our home in Fairfield, Alabama. 3 Kingfisher biplanes came screaming overhead so low that I could see the pilots waving at me. I got so excited, I almost fell off the roof. By the age of 9, that passion had shifted from flying to flying fighters to leading the Thunderbirds. For the first dozen or so years after college, I lived a dream that few rock and roll stars can compete with and flew the F-16 all over the world. About the time I could apply for the commander leader position on the Thunderbirds, I ran into a wall like few others. I was diagnosed with cancer. My family history is rife with the disease, and after a second operation, I was told to prepare for the battle of my lifetime, and that I would never fly again. Putting that childhood dream back up on the horizon helped me recover from one of my biggest setbacks, and capturing the dream came through a series of miracles that I will never be able to explain. What I found when I got there exceeded every expectation I had framed through the whims of adolescence. The annual turnover within the Thunderbirds was significant. We lost a third of our enlisted force, half the officers, and with them, half the pilots who flew the demonstration every year. That programmed attrition forced us to train a new team from the most basic level forward at the end of every demonstration season. In just 3.5 months of training, we took men and women who had never worked together and methodically developed the kind of trust that allowed them to thrive at the extremes of performance and risk. We really did trust one another with our lives, and the method the team developed to ingrain that kind of dynamic was nothing short of phenomenal. By the time I came on board, our organization had been refined by 48 generations of Thunderbird teams that streamed seamlessly into the one I led. The process that lineage passed on to our team was the best I've ever known. My goal in writing this book is to share the steps for generating trust at this level, trust that can further the nature of your team or workplace, no matter what you do. Along the way, I intend to engage a bias you may be carrying, that leading in the military is somehow different from leading in your world. Even in combat, getting people to deliver what your team needs depends on something much more than blind obedience. It relies on your deliberately building the foundational elements that compel the desire to follow. The biggest of those elements is trust. All the stories in this book are true, and while many of the names are those of actual people, others were changed to protect individual and organizational trajectories beyond our time together. The world of the fighter pilot is big on call signs, nicknames, and you will find many in the pages that follow. Some are simple, some are creative, and some are designed to make a relatively intense occupation a little more enjoyable. Introduction. Trust. No team or organization can excel over the long haul without it. And for many leaders, the path to establishing it is anything but clear. Trust is the willingness to put yourself or your team at risk with the belief that another will follow through with a task, in a role, or with a mission. Expressions of trust that lack an element of risk are merely expressions. Because you picked up this book, I will make some assumptions about you. You are a leader who cares about the performance and well-being of your people. But you sense that something, maybe gaps in trust or communication, are holding you and your team back. The good news is that you've taken a great step toward increasing the cohesion and performance of your team by just reading the introduction to this book. With each successive page, you will learn a bit more about a predictable, repeatable process for building trust within your team. A process that begins with an individual's desire for commitment from you and ends with his or her trust in you. Once you have finished the last page, you will see the process everywhere you turn and in every facet of your life. I will warn you right now that there are no shortcuts or quick solutions offered herein. As a matter of fact, I will ask you to take risks and move to engage your team in ways others might consider idealistic or unnecessary. But I promise you will be rewarded for your efforts. Biases, the barrier to trust. Whom do you trust and what made you cross that threshold? Whom don't you trust and what keeps you from believing in that person? Very often the decision comes not just from what we see, but from the events and experiences stored in the processors in our heads and our hearts. Any relationship begins with an introduction, and that first impression is lasting for reasons that are often hard to understand. Consciously or unconsciously, some facet about that person matches something inside of us, something that was coded in us during adolescence or that we absorbed or coded in ourselves along the path of our adult lives. Call them predispositions or intuition if you'd like, but right or wrong, biases reside in all of us. Biases are internal layers of protection that help us resist putting our physical, emotional, or financial well-being at risk. How you dress, act, and sound fit an internal mold in another's mind, a mold cast by a whole host of characters and events, good and bad, in their lives. Where you were raised in your culture, dialect, manners, and mannerisms match biases that directly or unconsciously shape how you view others and how others view you. Biases form the barrier to trust we are up against as leaders. Breaking the trust barrier. The challenging thing about biases is that you may never fully understand what they are in your own mind, much less in the minds of your people. With that as a backdrop, there is little use in dwelling on the indicators or rationales for biases. We can leave them to the people who study behavior. Our job as leaders is to overcome biases by building a portfolio of seamless actions and engagements that inspires our people to write new code, code that will incrementally entice them to close the trust gap. We will talk a great deal about gaps in this book, but the critical thing to remember is that closing the gaps on trust relies on the whole you. It begins with your commitment to the individuals on your team your willingness to actively engage and listen to the people you lead, and then your moving on the interests and passions you discover within those engagements to foster loyalty. The effort you spend building commitment and loyalty will take you to the threshold, but closing beyond the trust barrier relies on pulling your team forward with your integrity and your deeply seated principles. See Breaking Through. This book steps you through the process of closing gaps by introducing a new system of leadership called drafting. You have seen the aerodynamic phenomenon at work through the V formations of migratory birds, a train of speed skaters, stock car racers, and the likes, where the efficiencies and effects of teams are magnified with proximity. My 2 years on the point of the Thunderbirds offered some incredible insights on trust and the real effects and power of drafting. It was that experience and that incredible team that served as my inspiration for writing this book. Through 26 years of service and 2 tours of combat duty, I can say without reservation that every team I flew with or served on relied on trust. But as you read through each chapter, you will discover what I did about Thunderbirds, that our mission required a level of trust that few organizations will ever know or enjoy. It really was something else. Our process for building and sustaining trust is laid out here for you and your team. Read on, take hold of the reins, and break your barriers to trust. Part 1. Are there gaps on your team? A leader has 3 primary roles: set the direction, the vision for the team, attract and retain the best talent you can find, and build and protect the corporate culture. Robert Walter, founder and former CEO, Cardinal Health. Leo Van Wart is a professional golfer who helped propel Nota Begay III to the ranks of the Professional Golfers Association of America. Leo was hired to run a golf complex just outside of Las Vegas, and shortly after he arrived, he hopped in a golf cart and drove the expanse of his new course. Many fairways and greens were in disrepair, and the desert had all but reclaimed his new driving range. When he stopped by the grill and sampled its marquee item, a flavorless cheeseburger, he had a complete picture of why the course was bleeding money. The biggest gap he found in the operation was ownership. No one on the small team took pride of ownership in the work. There was no sense of cohesion or unity. To them, the course was just a job. Does that sound familiar? A gap is a physical or emotional distance caused by a lack of competence, a lack of confidence, or an unmet social need. No matter what your profession is or how impressive your team may be to an outsider, you know that there are gaps keeping your team from maximizing its potential. That is true for every organization, and it was certainly true for the Thunderbirds. We build ourselves as the Air Force's #1 recruiting tool, and our book said that more than 10 million people experienced the Thunderbirds in one way or another every year. We put on an air show that was first rate. By all appearances, the team was firing on every cylinder when I came on board. But shortly thereafter, I found a few things that were hard to reconcile. The Air Force Recruiting Service ran a series of high-profile television commercials the year I took command. And the Thunderbirds, the Air Force's #1 recruiting tool, was not in a single frame. That was telling. The more I listened, the more I heard my new team complain about strained, deteriorating, or non-existent relationships with the Air Force Recruiting Service, with our parent public affairs organization, and with other offices and agencies we should have been supporting, or whose support we needed to conduct our mission. The more I sought out the math surrounding that 10 million people per year figure, the more elusive it became. And our metrics, methods, and alliances were not adding up to that powerful slogan. Positive exposure to the general public was our mission, and even under that banner you could find issues. We had endured a series of aircraft mishaps and personal conduct issues in our more recent history, which caused senior leaders to pull signature maneuvers and formations from the demonstration. The trends were clear, and our critical metrics were headed in the wrong direction. Gaps in the Thunderbird operation. The team was running hard, but our laser focus on operations, on flying the demonstration, allowed gaps to develop in the performance of our overall mission, and we were falling short of our real potential to reach the public. Again, from the outside, we were holding our own, but we clearly had three organizational gaps in performance: outreach, complacency, and discipline. Spotting the gaps on your team. If you are new to an operation, just walking the grounds will give you a great deal of perspective. If you have been with the team for a while, get away for long enough to gain a bit of perspective, then come back and take a fresh look. As you move about, make sure you take the time to watch and listen to your people. Most of us get elevated into leadership roles on our ability to speak up, but the move to a position on point requires an adjustment. One of the best pieces of advice I received for spotting gaps was from Brigadier General Thomas Grizz Walters, USAF retired. "Never miss the opportunity to shut the expletive up." Your people will talk freely if you let them, and their words will paint a picture of the exceptional areas and the gaps in your operation. Once you have an assessment in hand, you can build or refine your team's goals, elevate its trajectory, and craft a plan to close the gaps to the point where you break the barrier to trust. The road ahead. We ease into the process of drafting by giving you a vivid glimpse of how it all began. From there, we step into the Thunderbird hangar and show you how we took people who didn't know one another and had never flown formation acrobatics before, and in a little more than 3 months, moved them from commitment to unqualified trust. There is a surge in momentum waiting for you just ahead, so strap yourself in and let's get started. Chapter 1. Draft Your Team to Trust. It was a gorgeous day in the middle of the Thunderbird show season, and we were flying over some of the most breathtaking countryside I had ever seen. The radios were crisp, and from the moment we released brakes, we were hitting all the marks in a compressed maneuver sequence we had been perfecting for months. The four of us completed our reposition behind the crowd line and then stabilized for just a second. The moment we passed over those 40,000 people, I pulled the trigger on the next maneuver. The 4G pull that started our trail to Diamond Clover Loop stabilized, and just as we approached the vertical, I called the three jets behind me to move from their trail position to our signature diamond. At the start of training season, the distance between jets was the same as we had flown throughout our operational lives. But now the formations were so tight and the gaps between us so small that I thought I could feel a shift as the left and right wingmen moved into position. So far as I knew, the surge that came with Rick Chase Boutwell and John Skid Green moving into their respective formations was emotional, but it felt like they were literally lifting the wings of my jet. As each accelerated into position that day, a very subtle shift took hold of our trajectory. The pressure came on as if a giant hand were pushing up on my left wing. The ensuing right turn began to take us away from a pure vertical loop, and almost unconsciously, I countered with the call for a little left turn and the slightest amount of pressure on the stick to bring us back on plumb. From the crowd's perspective, this would be one of the best demonstrations of the year, and most spectators would leave with a level of pride that matched the wave of exhilaration we were riding as the last jet touched down. And yet the blemish of that Trail to Diamond Clover Loop was still lingering in the back of my mind. I knew I hadn't consciously turned the flight, but I was at a loss as to how the maneuver had gone wrong. After I watched the video recording of our demonstration in the debrief, I noticed a small difference. My left wingman was more aggressive on his move forward, and he tucked into position a bit more quickly and closely than the jet on my right, and he stayed there. He was so close that he caused my left wing to become more efficient, to produce more lift than my right wing. Efficiencies. It was aerodynamic efficiencies. It wasn't just a feeling that I was being carried by the team around me. The surge brought on from their proximity was real. That thought would change the way I looked at everything. We were drafting. The Phenomenon of Drafting. The aerodynamic phenomenon of drafting was discovered in the late 1950s by stock car racers who figured out that two cars running close together, nose to tail, could sustain a faster speed than either car could achieve on its own. Over time, they figured out the cause of the effect. The lead car was taking on the wall of air for both, while the trailer was close enough to the leader's bumper to relieve it from the drag it created as it moved down the track. See aerodynamic drafting. While the effects are mutually beneficial, they are a little lopsided, at least at first. When a car speeds down the track, its movement plows a path through the air to create a vacuum of sorts that can help pull a trail car forward when it is still several car lengths behind the leader. And if the trailer elects to close on the leader's bumper, the pull becomes more significant with every foot of closure on the leader's car. But funny enough, the leader gains no relief from its drag until the trailer is within a single car length. As the trail car closes inside that distance, the leader's drag begins to transfer from its bumper to that of the trailer. When the gap closes, the collective effect allows the team of two cars to accelerate to a speed that neither car could achieve on its own. It is closing the distance, the gaps between elements on a team, that makes drafting work. The more I thought about it, the more I could see drafting's effects on the Thunderbirds everywhere I turned. Every unit within our organization, from accounting and finance to maintenance and public affairs, literally every shop, was minimally staffed, and each relied on the others to help it execute its role. Those amazing people were lined up bumper to bumper, taking the weight, the drag off the individual or element in front of them, while they sustained the draft for those behind them. Drafting, in teamwork, is a phenomenon that replicates the aerodynamic benefits of bodies moving closely together. It requires leaders to inspire closure between individuals and entities to deliver cohesion, unity of effort, and team acceleration. Think about that in terms of you and your team. How many folks are snuggled up against your bumper, taking the drag off your efforts, and how many are sitting two car lengths back, smoking a lucky while basking in the warmth of your draft? It is absolutely up to the folks in your wake to close the distance. You cannot make them close. It is up to us as leaders to set the conditions that will make them want to close the gaps. By incrementally building mutual commitment, then loyalty, and finally the kind of trust that will further the momentum of the whole team, we maximize the effects of drafting. Closing the gaps with commitment, loyalty, and trust. Trust comes through a series of methodical actions that begin and end with the leader. No pilot begins the first day of his tour with the Thunderbirds flying inches away from another's wing. That kind of proximity relies on trust that is built over time. Closing those gaps must be done incrementally through a methodical process that, more than any other facet, relies on you. Before we go into the process of building trust, let's clear up one possible misconception right up front. The Thunderbirds are not all that different from your team. Certainly some aspects of our mission made us unique, so let's get them out of the way now. Differences from team to team. The Thunderbirds flight training program taught pilots who had never flown formation aerobatics everything from basic formations to the entire jet demonstration sequence. We started in mid-November, flying two jets side by side, executing one maneuver over and over, 1 mile above the desert floor, with 3 feet of separation between jets. As the training progressed, we would methodically add jets and maneuver elements, lower the maneuvering floor until we had all six F-16 fighters flying maneuvers 400 feet above the ground. By the end of the training season, the gaps between aircraft were as small as 18 inches. In mid-March, the team packed up and went on the road for the next 8 months to fly air shows all over the world. With the deployments, practices, air shows, and redeployments home, we flew 6 days a week through the middle of November. The day after we finished the last air show, we started the team-building process all over again. While the differences may seem stark between our operation and yours, the parallels in personalities are an absolute match. Without question, the mission of the Thunderbirds was unique, and the expectations for precision were very high. But the makeup of personnel in our hangar was very similar to the composition of your team right now.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.